those of you who have attended these events before know that they're run to the nearest second. So it's time for the broadcast to begin. Not what you will hear here, but you will hear it a split second or a few seconds before the other audience for technical reasons. This evening, I'd like to introduce our speaker, Dava Sobel, to begin with a little bit of a historical introduction, a little bit unusual. I'm thinking back to 1693, when it was the birthday of John Harrison, the man who had invented the chronometer, the strange, mysterious-shaped clocks getting smaller and smaller as the technology grew. Our curator of the Historical Scientific Instruments Collection was rather shocked to discover that the British were not celebrating the 300th anniversary of John Harrison. So he proposed to have a symposium here. Those of us in the History of Science department figured that, well, okay, there might be 30 people who are interested in this and prepared to come. What they didn't know, but Will Andrews knew, was that the Clock and Watch Collectors Society had hundreds of people as their members, and he invited them all. So he had a full house and a full banquet, and then he came around and said, "We need your help. We want really a very special speaker for the banquet." Well, I, of course, figured he was coming to ask me, and he said, "We'd like to get Alastair Cook." And some of you will remember the name. He used to introduce some of the special programs on WGBH and wrote his messages about America back for an English audience. So I said, well, I think I can at least make a try to get his telephone number for you. And I happened to know the president of WGBH, and I asked him for the telephone number, who handed it to me and said, good luck. And what do you know? Will Andrews persuaded Alastair Cook to come as the after-dinner speaker at the banquet. Now, meantime, Dava Sobel, who was a science writer in all sorts of publications, including the New York Times, had wanted to come to this meeting. Sounded like fun, but she couldn't get anybody interested in it. Suddenly, Harvard discovered that Alastair Cook was coming, and they realized this was going to be an event. And so they got on the telephone and asked Dava if she would come and write it up for Harvard Magazine. Well, that was the beginning of an interesting and unexpected saga, because there was a wonderful article in Harvard Magazine, and I suppose she thought that was the end of it. But a Harvard alumnus, George Gibson, was the head of Walker Books, and he read the article. He was a Harvard alum and read the article and decided that this would make an interesting book, and got Dava interested in trying her hand at writing a whole book that way. George was an interesting editor. He didn't rewrite anything. He just filled the margins of the manuscript with comments about this is great or this is redundant, and lots of very helpful things. And then he put it out in a nice small format so that bookstores could stack it right beside the cash register. And it was amazing what happened, because counting the English sales, and so on. In the various editions, it's around 1 million copies have been sold. So that's part of the secret background for Dava Sobel. And I wanted you to know about that. That was the way she got started, but that wasn't the end of it, because there is Galileo's Daughter, another interesting book, and, well, various ones, but over here in a great stack is the most recent one. All right, I've captured 5 minutes of your time, Dava. We want to hear you, not me.
I just remembered I had never seen it. I just remembered I have wonderful cough medicine with me, which I forgot to take. I'm going to have to hope I do okay without it. Thank you. Thank you for that introduction. I'm going to make a small excuse for myself because I've not been well. I hope everybody can hear me. This is about as loud as I can go. And I'm very happy to be back. I was here in December when the book came out, the book The Glass Universe. And tonight I want to give a different kind of talk because I think we have more people here who were not here in December. And I'm calling it The Universe Next Door, because the glass universe of the book's title is actually right next door. And tonight there will be tours for those of you who are interested in seeing the plate stacks. This is your chance. 500,000 glass photographs that were taken over a period of about 100 years and are all preserved right next door are available for you to look at tonight. Lindsay Smith, who's the curator of the collection now, will be having a tour, several tours, because only a few people can go in there at a time. When you go in, you'll see why. It's mostly glass plates. There isn't a lot of room for people to stand about. Here's Lindsay. That gave me a pointer. So here are the plates. This is how they are stacked up in these nice folders. Some of the folders are from the 1800s and still have markings on them. And here are record books that have been kept so that people explain what they were doing as they analyzed the plates. And you'll probably be able to see some of that too. This building was actually built where we're sitting now is absent from this picture. Is that the only thing left from this picture is this object and the original telescope that's still up there, which was a gift from the people of Boston. But the old building was wooden. And as soon as these photographic plates started accumulating, the director worried all the time what would happen if there were a fire. And so he agitated to get a brick building constructed. And the first part of it was finished in 1893. And it held the first batch of those plates. This is Edward Pickering. He was not the first director of the observatory, but he came here in 1877. He was very young, just barely 30, and he had been teaching at MIT, teaching physics. And it was controversial that as a physicist he'd been hired as the director of the observatory, but he was very well thought of. And at MIT he had created a laboratory where students had to really learn by themselves, by doing experiments that he had created. And he was unusually welcoming to women. Not that MIT was welcoming to women, but he was. And when women approached him that they wanted to take his class or learn how to teach physics the way he was teaching it, he let them into the class. This is the beautiful old telescope that is still up in the dome, that, as I said, was a gift from the people of Boston. And this is wonderful old chair that was created by the original director, William Cranch Bond. I don't know. There's also going to be a tour tonight by Thomas Dames of the sites around the building that are historically important. They don't look the way they used to, but you'll get the drift, I'm sure. Here's Lindsay again at the telescope. I just found this picture recently. The telescope isn't really working, but I'm glad they posed her like this. I think it's very impressive. So one of the strange things about Pickering's being so open to having women here, and when he came in 1877, he found several women working in the observatory, and they were mostly the wives, sisters, and daughters of the resident astronomers who had been brought in to do calculations, and they did very well, so that by the time he arrived, there was also a woman here who had been hired from outside the observatory family. And they were not college graduates. There was a worry sparked or capitalized upon by this book, Sex and Education, A Fair Chance for the Girls. That is a really misleading subtitle, because what this book actually said was that if girls devoted themselves to higher education at this important moment in life, their reproductive organs would atrophy. So, I mean, you laugh, but this is what the new women's colleges were up against. Smith, Wellesley, Mount Holyoke, they were all founded in the 1870s. So this was the tension. And Pickering thought this was ridiculous. And he not only made jobs available to women, actual jobs in the observatory, but he invited the alumni of the women's colleges, especially those who had taken astronomy and who own telescopes, to make their own observations and send in their findings, which he would publish and credit them for. So this is a group of women he hired in this new brick building. This woman at the back is Wilhelmina Fleming. She was one of the first people he brought in. He actually hired her as a maid. She was in desperate straits. She was a married woman, or had been a married woman, and she was pregnant. And her husband had disappeared, and so she took this job as a domestic servant. But he recognized her intelligence and moved her over to the observatory. And then helped her to go home to Scotland. She was a Scottish immigrant. Helped her to go home to Scotland to have her baby, and promised her a real job if she would come back. So she stayed in Scotland about 2 years, and then she left the baby with her mother and came back. And she was so grateful to the Pickerings that she named the baby Edward Charles Pickering Fleming. And you often hear the story that Pickering dressed down some of his male employees by saying, "My maid could do a better job." I'm ready to swear that never happened, because I've read hundreds of Pickering's letters, and I want to tell you he was the most polite person who ever lived. And the thought that he could treat a subordinate that way is just completely out of character. So this is one of the plates. Most of them There are many different types of photographs. Pickering was one of the first people in astronomy to seriously get behind photography. You may know that the first photograph of a star was taken right here at Harvard by William Cranch Bond and his son, George Phillips Bond. But the telescope wasn't really good for taking pictures, and photography was at a very rudimentary point, so they didn't carry it too far. But by the time Pickering came in about 20 years later, things had changed, and he saw the future of astronomy in photography. And many observers didn't, were worried about that, or even offended. How could a photograph be better than my trained eye? But in fact, the photographic plate, because it could accumulate light over time, would capture stars that couldn't be seen through the most powerful telescopes. So he was all for it. And his younger brother, William, was experimenting with photography, and he hired William to come here and help initiate a serious program in photography. So this is a comet, and it's a positive image. Most of the images look like this. They're negatives, so the stars look black on a white background. And then some of the images are actually of spectra. So there's been a prism placed over the light-gathering end of the telescope, and all the stars in the field have their lights spread out like this. And you'll notice, this is a penny, by the way, just for scale. You'll notice that the different little strips don't look the same. And this was what was so interesting. This was what the project was about that brought so many women to work here. Let me do one more image here before I talk more about the spectra. This is an image of the plate, of two of the plates on a scanner bed, because the 500,000 plates next door are not just interesting as museum pieces, they are still in use. They represent a unique, irreplaceable resource, a record of the sky over a period of 100 years. And so they are being digitized. Now, this is a process in progress, and that's how they look when they're on the scanner. Some of the volunteers in the project are here tonight. Maybe they'll say a few words later. And everything about this process had to be invented. And when it's finished, people won't have to come here to look at the plates. Of course, the plates are fragile, they're glass, and they'll be available online. So this couple made the first steps in photographing the spectra of the stars. This is Dr. Henry Draper, who was a medical doctor in New York, so he was an amateur astronomer. And as many of you know, astronomy has been a field that welcomes amateurs, and amateurs have always played a really important part. Henry Draper built his own telescopes, he developed his own techniques, and he trained his wife, Anna Palmer Draper, as his assistant. And they worked together for about 15 years until they got to the point where they were going to devote themselves entirely to this project, to be photographing the spectra of the stars and looking at the different patterns and using those to figure out a classification system, a taxonomy of the stars, to be able to tell what chemicals they were made of, and what different types they divided into. And, well, let me just show you. Here is a textbook picture of a spectrum, what that looks like. So when you see it today, look at a star through a spectrograph. You see the different colors and the dark lines that help make the patterns. Except photography was not color when the Drapers were working. So this is more what the things looked like. Let me leave that up. So just as the Drapers got ready to gave up his teaching position, they were going to move up to Hastings on Hudson, New York, to their private observatory and devote their rest of their lives to this, he developed pneumonia and died. So he was 45 years old. And she was determined to carry on his dream, see that project realized, but she couldn't find the kind of help she needed to do it. Not even two people added up to one Henry. So she turned to Edward Pickering, who had been a friend of theirs, and offered him her personal fortune to do the work in her husband's name. And at a stroke, she about tripled the operating budget of the observatory. The observatory got no funding from the university, had to raise its own money. So this was what enabled Pickering to hire more women to come in for the analysis of these photographs. It was still considered unseemly to have the women observing at night with the men, but during the day, they could look at the photographs and work on this problem of classification. So here's Mrs. Fleming again. This woman is Antonia Mori. She was the first one who came here as a college graduate from Vassar College, and she was Henry Draper's niece. That's part of how she got her job. This is Pickering's desk. He had a desk upstairs in this building. I'm sure you'll see what room it was in. And it was just the most clever thing that he designed. So it has this rotating bookcase in the middle. And the base also rotates, 12 drawers, 12 workspaces, the equivalent of about 24 feet of tabletop. It's really quite ingenious. Here's Mrs. Fleming again. So she had been a school teacher in Scotland, but she didn't have anything beyond a high school education herself. And in her work here, she not only created the first stellar classification, the first Henry Draper classification, published in 1890, was her work. And then she became, and Pickering credited her for having done all the work in print. And in 1900, she was the first woman ever to have a Harvard University title. He made her curator of astronomical photographs. And although it was a job in the observatory, it was a university title. Here's Antonia Mori in her college photograph. This is Mariah Mitchell. Antonia studied at Vassar. She had, I think, 8 semesters of astronomy with Mariah Mitchell, who was really the first lady of American astronomy. She had discovered a comet in 1847 that made her world famous. And so when Matthew Vassar founded his women's college, he brought her in to teach astronomy. This woman is Annie Jump Cannon. She came here in 1896, and she really had a background in observational astronomy. She was a Wellesley graduate, and she was the first one to come here and really be allowed to use the telescope. Not the 15-inch, but a smaller one. Here she is at Wellesley. This is her assisting in the kind of physics lab that Pickering had established at MIT, and that her teacher had learned firsthand from Pickering. So she had Miss Cannon had a direct line to Pickering through her teacher. And she also was the crackerjack analyst of the stellar spectra. So here they are again, spectra all over. And then she writes a number next to each one, and then as she's studying the plate, she calls out the number and says, this one's type A, this one's type O, this one's type M. For those of you, I'm guessing a lot of you here are regulars at these talks and probably know that even now, the types of stars are designated by letters of the alphabet, except the alphabet is not in alphabetical order. It goes O, B, A, F, G, K, M. And the way students are still taught to remember that is with the mnemonic, oh, be a fine girl or guy, kiss me. Definitely not the sort of work that anyone could do. And she was very quick at it. And she analyzed hundreds of thousands of stars for what is still known today as the Henry Draper catalog. When I first came to this story, one of the many chip on the shoulder anecdotes I heard was, yeah, Miss Cannon did all the work, but it's named for a man. Well, yes, it's named for a man because Mrs. Draper provided all the money to do all the work on the grounds that her beloved departed husband would be remembered. It's not named for a man out of spite to Miss Cannon. One of the great things that helped me in my research here was the abundance of materials available from this period. The observatory records are preserved, partly here, mostly in the university archives. And here are two cartons from the university archives depository. And those are Miss Cannon's diaries. She was a lifelong diarist. And takes a while to get the hang of her handwriting. But once you do, it's all there. She was also a prolific letter writer and saved letters from people all over. She was a little bit like Forrest Gump in that she knew everybody. She became world famous in her own lifetime, was an officer of the American Astronomical Society and a respected foreign member of numerous international astronomical societies. Excuse me. So in order to make the photographic record of the sky complete, Pickering needed the Southern Hemisphere. Not just the northern that he could see from Cambridge, but the southern hemisphere. And he sent this man, Solon Bailey, who showed up here as an amateur volunteer, to go to South America and reconnoiter a site for building a new telescope. And it didn't look too promising here, but they really persevered. The tremendous personal hardship in these travels took great determination, perseverance. This is what it came to be, ultimately, in the shadow. So this is called the Boyden Station in Arequipa, Peru. And it was called the Boyden Station because it was built with the fortune of Uriah Boyden, who... an eccentric, wealthy man who left a lot of money for the purpose of building an observatory at a high altitude. And Pickering finagled to get that money for Harvard. So this is a famous volcano, El Misti. They thought it was extinct. Turned out to be mostly dormant. But it didn't cause them too much trouble. And this building here is where the Pickering's Dream Telescope got built. This is called the Bruce Telescope. It had 24-inch aperture, and it's called the Bruce Telescope in honor of its donor. So Pickering, let it be known, he needed $50,000 to build this telescope for the Southern Station. And Catherine Wolfe Bruce was an elderly New York heiress with an interest in astronomy. She wrote him a check, just like that. So that was one of the things that was so interesting to me about this story, that there were so many women doing the work, but then also women providing the money for the work to be done. Here's a scene in Peru. This is Solon Bailey. This is his wife, Ruth Poulter Bailey. They took their very young child with them to Peru. He pretty much grew up down there, later became a Harvard professor of botany, Irving Bailey. But she was a great help to her husband, both in the astronomy and in conducting the meteorology. There were several meteorology stations set up all around Peru. Bailey was most interested in these objects called globular clusters, you know, typical astronomy term, very clear. You don't have to wonder what that means. It's a big glob of stars. This is a close-up of the same thing. And one of the things he and his wife tried to do was to count the stars in the globular clusters. And they would draw a reticule, a glass piece of graph paper that they would put over the photograph, and then just try to count the stars in each box and add them up. You can see when they get all the way to the center, it becomes impossible. But that was the kind of focus. And they would both count and compare their numbers and then average. And he was especially interested in the variable stars. So you're not only looking at all these tiny dots and counting them, but then you're looking at them over and over again over time and seeing how they change in their brightness, their magnitude. So, tremendous attention to detail. The Bruce plates were very large, about 11 by 14 by 17 inches, whereas the others are more like 8 by 10. And this woman, Henrietta Swan Leavitt, was given the Bruce plates to study, especially of a, I think I have a picture of it, yeah. She was especially interested in this object. This is called the Small Magellanic Cloud, because Magellan reported it on his journeys, and it kept his name, even when people realized it was not really a cloud at all, but a great swarm of stars. And Henrietta Leavitt was really the first name I heard in this story. I interviewed astronomer Wendy Friedman. It must have been 25 years ago. And she was the head of a Hubble telescope key project regarding the expansion rate of the universe. And she mentioned the name Henrietta Leavitt as being the person whose discovery was fundamental to distance estimates being made even now. And I had never heard the name before. And then when I went to learn more about Henrietta Leavitt, I discovered that she'd been working in this room full of women at Harvard, which just seemed so ridiculous. You know, in the 1890s, when did Harvard ever give that kind of opportunity to that many women? That was a story. So she was looking for variable stars and finding enormous numbers of them in this odd, hundreds and hundreds of them. And she noticed in studying them over time, these are all more or less the same distance away. But the ones that attained the greatest brightness took the longest period of time to go through their cycle. And that struck her as something worthy of note. And she published her findings. And again, was actually published by Pickering, but he said that it was her discovery, and the publication was just the way the astronomy circulars were done. The director wrote them. And so her finding was very quickly calibrated so that this difference in the stars was used to figure out the actual distance to the small Magellanic Cloud. And from there, to other objects. Harlow Shapley was also very interested in these clusters and took over as director after Edward Pickering died. And he used Miss Leavitt's discovery to gauge the size of the Milky Way. And by his estimate, it was so gigantic that he felt confident it was the sum total of the universe. Other people thought there were other galaxies in space, that the Milky Way was just one among many. But once he got a sense of its size, he was sure that that was not the case. Shapley, as some of you may know, was also very interested in ants. He developed this interest while he was working at Mount Wilson, before he took over here at Harvard, and he would just observe them and create little speed traps for them to walk through, and he made this discovery that their speed of travel depended on the ambient temperature. And he published this. And he was always convinced that he could tell the temperature, but just by watching the ants moving across the sidewalk. So I have to include this New Yorker cartoon. You know, nowadays the New Yorker has a contest where you just see the picture and you try to write your own caption. But this actually has a caption. And the caption is, "Makes you feel small, doesn't it?" One of the things Shapley said when he figured out the size of the Milky Way was that he loved the idea that it was huge and the Earth and Sun were nowhere near the center of it, so man was not such a big chicken. There was another heiress, a relative of Mariah Mitchell, who was very interested in the work going on at Harvard and very helpful in bringing in young women. This is Margaret Harwood. So she was the first Nantucket fellowship holder. This relative of Mariah Mitchell's lived on Nantucket, and the position gave Miss Harwood a chance to do research on Nantucket and also to teach astronomy there and lecture. And then in the winter months, she would work at Harvard. She was a Radcliffe graduate. And this went on for many years, starting in Pickering's era. And the heiress's name was Lydia Hinchman. And Miss Harwood made such a hit that she was quickly made the permanent Nantucket fellowship holder. And she went on to be director of the Nantucket Observatory for more than 40 years. So Mrs. Hinchman endowed another fellowship for other women. And by the time she got finished, there were two or three. And one of them was called the Pickering Fellowship for Women, in honor of Pickering's good treatment of young women looking to have careers in astronomy. So Shapley inherited this fellowship money, and he was bent on creating a program in graduate education in astronomy. And the only money available to give graduate fellowships were these Pickering fellowships for women. So the first graduate students brought here were recruited from the women's colleges. This is Adelaide Ames. She was the first from Vassar, and Cecilia Payne, who came all the way from England because she had been told that there was no future for her as an astronomer in England. But at Harvard, you know, things were different, and if she could get one of those fellowships, there was hope for her. And she met Shapley when he was lecturing in London and told him that she wanted to come work for him. And he helped her make things happen. Oops, sorry. So here she is again. She came over on this fellowship, and he wanted her to go all the way through to a PhD. He recognized her tremendous ability. And she came from Newnham College at Cambridge, and she really knew about atomic theory. She was the first person at Harvard to look at atomic theory in relation to the stellar spectra. And in the course, so she became the first Harvard PhD in astronomy. Not the first woman to get a Harvard PhD, but the first Harvard PhD in astronomy in 1925. And in the course of her research, she was looking at the composition of the stars and the relative abundances of the different substances. And people had seen in the stars many of the same elements that exist in the Earth. And there was a sense that the proportions would be similar. And according to her findings, hydrogen was just out of all proportion. It was something like a million times more prevalent than anything else. And she did point that out, and she was advised not to make too much of that fact. It just was contrary to expectations. So she reported it in her dissertation, but she said that it was probably a spurious result. And it took the astronomy community, spearheaded by Henry Norris Russell, only 4 years to do more study and come around to her way of thinking and say, you know, it really is mostly hydrogen. Here's the group. Here's Annie Cannon. Here's Henrietta Leavitt. A couple of Pickering fellows in here. And the, it is possible to see something demeaning in this photograph, the way they're all lined up like paper dolls. But I don't think it was meant that way. I think it was a place of great good fellowship. These people really loved what they were doing. They were married to the job. They worked here 6 days a week, and on Saturday night they socialized together. And it was very formal. Some of them worked together four decades and never arrived at a first name basis. recently, it's a great story, you know, but people forget great stories. What they did here, and it had been largely forgotten. But it's been picked up by quite a few people in recent years. I was surprised when I started my book that nobody had written a book like that, that it just seemed to be waiting for me. I was really glad, but I was surprised. In the recent remake of Carl Sagan's Cosmos series, there was a cartoon episode called The Sisters of the Sun. I mean, there were a lot of cartoons in the remake. but here's Miss Leavitt, and here's Miss Cannon. And they are they were the subject of one of the episodes. Here is a posed image back in by the 15-inch right here of the cast of a play by Lauren Gunderson called The Silent Sky. And this is the Flat Earth Theater production of it. I'm actually hoping to see it tomorrow night if I get better. And the play is about, mostly about Henrietta Leavitt. It's not, it's a fiction. It's a dramatization, and it's largely a love story. But it does allude to her love for her work, which is the best part of it. There is also a web series now based on another play about the Harvard women. The other play was called Insignificant, and it ran in New York for about a month, a little over a year ago. So this is Miss Maury. And I think this is Miss Cannon, but I could be wrong. And so Insignificant, the web series. You heard about it here. And of course you've heard about Hidden Figures. Has anybody not heard about Hidden Figures? So I thought it was odd that there were three books about women computers that came out in 1 year. First was The Rise of the Rocket Girls by Nathalia Holt, which is about the women who worked at JPL. Then came Hidden Figures in last September by Margot Lee Shetterly about the black women who worked at NASA Langley and were segregated from the white female computers, a terrific story that was immediately grabbed up for the movies before the book was even written, just from the book proposal. And some of you will recognize Alyssa Goodman here, Harvard professor of astronomy. And her NASA meatball is not quite NASA, it's nasty. She is one of the people I approached as a technical expert to read my manuscript and correct my astronomy mistakes. And she got completely sidetracked by the women's story. She said, you know, I've been here, I'm teaching here, and I never, you know, I always thought that the story about the ladies was something quaint or cute. I didn't realize they were actually doing science. So she agitated to have our book launch here in the observatory so we could talk about the women's history. This is an unhappy part of recent history. Pickering had been fixated for years on protecting the glass plates from fire. And a year ago January, there was a water main burst. And something like 60,000 of those plates were submerged in water that was none too clean. And there was a phenomenal show of goodwill and support. Volunteers flocked to the plate stacks to carry the damaged plates out of the water. And the curator, then Allison Doan, contacted the, I'm going to forget the name of it now, but there is a group that does restoration, archival restoration on campus. They're experts in all kinds of materials, paper, glass. And they said the crucial thing is to get the plates out of the water and someplace where it's cold and dry. And at the moment, it was freezing outside and dry. So all the plates got carried upstairs and outdoors. And then they were taken away to a place where they're being kept frozen, and little by little they will be brought back and cleaned, and the digitization project will continue. It is continuing. And because so much equipment was damaged in the flood, new equipment goes faster, so they hope to finish the work on the same time scale. And the plates aren't the only things here that are worthy of digitization. The record books, too. There is a program, Phaedra, preserving Harvard's early astronomical data. I've scrambled that acronym a little, but you can learn more about it. There's a crowdsourcing platform, the Smithsonian Institution's platform. You can actually look at pages from the record books and type in what you see written there. So eventually all this material will be digitized. I'm looking at some of Miss Cannon's record books. Yes. Finally have a use for having learned how to read her handwriting. Looking forward to many happy years of this. So here they are again. Here's Cecilia Payne, this is Margaret Harwood, Annie Cannon, Antonia Mori. It's obviously a posed photograph, but again, you know, a cohesive unit, people who really accomplished a lot together. And I think in this era, this time of alternate facts, I'm very happy to have been able to tell a true story about science, about women in science, and thank all of you for coming to listen and hear more about them.
We're going to have time for some questions, but in the course of this fascinating lecture, I realized that there was something else I was going to say when I was introducing you. And that is, this is not the first talk I've heard you give, and I heard a very interesting talk some years ago on Galileo's daughter. It included a reading of it, and I was enchanted by it. Dava was challenging me because she knew I was skeptical about the basic thesis of the book. But, you know, when you're reading a book for fact-finding and just to look for a few misspellings or wrong dates or something like that, you never quite sense how brilliantly written it is. And hearing her actually do a reading from her book was just fascinating. And I mentioned that to George Gibson, her editor. And he said, that's interesting. It happened to me exactly that same way.
I didn't know that. Thank you.
I wanted you to hear that story. So I'll let you field the questions.
Well, I want to add something to that story. Because when I got the idea for that book, to translate Galileo's daughter's letters and try to tell his story with her story as background, I approached a few experts in history of science to say, is it a good idea? You know, before I took on the job of translating the letters, which I knew was going to take a long time. And Owen's response was, well, as far as I know, he dumped the girls in the convent and never looked back. And I said, well, yeah, but I'm looking at these letters now. She keeps asking him for things, and then a few days later, she always thanks him for whatever it was she asked him for in the first place. And Owen said, well, you'll have to convince me. So you were my audience for that book. Who wrote the book to you, which helped me think about how to phrase things. How to make it sound that way. So
I'm glad it all worked out. All right.
Here's a question.
Yeah. Great talk. Thank you. Did any of the women try to do it all as in marriage and kids?
Did any of the women try to do it all as marriage and children? Not at the beginning. The beginning, if you got married, you left. Mrs. Fleming was unusual, way ahead of her time, especially being a working mother. And I think I forgot to mention that she managed to put her son through MIT. He became a mining engineer and was quite successful. Later, things eased up, and Miss Cannon, who never married, was all for young women getting married and keeping their jobs. She was vocal about that and very encouraging. So her assistant got married. Her assistant was Margaret Walton, later Margaret Walton Male. And it became, by the 1930s, you didn't have to leave automatically.
Yeah, hi, I read the book, so I have a bit of an advantage. You mentioned your assistant, which gave me a question. Throughout the book, you talk about the women talking to their recorders or their assistants. And I guess, is there a backstory about them? Are they also women in the same sort of situation? And those journals, the other question that comes to mind about that is those journals that you point out, are they in, say, Miss Cannon's handwriting or her recorder's handwriting, do you think?
I think the journals are in just about everybody's handwriting. There are pages from all the different women. And the other question was, what about the recorders versus the... So, the beginning, people took turns because you couldn't keep looking. I mean, you've seen those images now. You don't want to be looking at that and then turn around to write something down. That's just going to be a waste of time. So you're speaking aloud what you're seeing to a recorder. But I think they went back and forth. And when Pickering did his photometry work at the telescope, it was the same thing. One person would be looking through and speaking aloud to a recorder, and then they would switch because their eyes would get so tired. So they took turns. Yes.
So a lot of people know the main Henrietta Leavitt, Cannon, Payne, and Miss Fleming. Is there any other computers that you wish more people knew their backstory?
There are many other computers. I'm going to repeat the question. Did everybody hear the question? What about the others beyond the most famous ones? I wish I knew the backstories of many more of them. That's the real problem. There are some I was able to find a few things about, and I put what I could. But these were people who were very serious about their work, and most of the letters and papers they left were about their work. Miss Cannon was very unusual in keeping a diary, as she did, for as long as she did. So we could name Ida Woods, Florence Cushman, Evelyn Leland. These people come up, and I kind of know what work they did before they got here. But in terms of the day-to-dayness of their lives, I couldn't get at it. And even with the main ones, I worried at the beginning how much of that information would be available. So that part of the record is thin. But I'm still looking, and maybe you will look, too. Anyone else?
Did they develop any specialized instruments for doing their work?
Yes. And you'll see one of the specialized instruments over in the plate stack. It's called a fly spanker. You know, you're looking at those pictures and you want to assess the brightness of a star. So how do you do that? One way to do it is to have images of stars of certain different brightnesses, like the legend on a map, to have that handy. So something on glass, small, like that was created, with a frame around it and then a wire handle, so it looked a little bit like a fly swatter. And they could hold that next to the stars they were looking at. And it was called a fly spanker because it was too small to really do a fly much damage. Yes.
When they were developing the funding and developing the Draper catalog, was there anything, were there particular discoveries or theses, hypotheses that they were trying to prove, or was it just an inventory and the discoveries came later?
When they were developing the Draper catalog, they were looking at the lines in the spectrum, and they were just looking for pattern. They didn't really know what the lines meant. Pickering was sure that someday it would become clear what it meant, but at the beginning, it was going to be just a pure judgment call. It turned out to have to do with temperature. And the sequence that Miss Cannon arrived at was actually a temperature sequence in order. But it wasn't known at the beginning. It might be temperature, it might be life stage in the evolution of the star. It's remarkable to think about how little was known at the beginning of that project and how much had been figured out by the end of it. It's really one of the thrilling parts of the story, and I think one of the reasons the story hadn't been done, because it was a lot of science. And some people still look at this book and think, that's a lot of science. we don't mean it in a nice way. But that's the story, that they were in on these discoveries. It must have been so exciting. And I think they really had a sense of how important the work was, of the opportunity they'd been given. Yes?
Do you have any favorite moment or idea that you discovered traveling through all these many stories that
you Do you have a favorite moment?
Yeah, some favorite discovery.
Well, one favorite moment was opening the box with the diaries. I had no idea what to expect. I mean, I just took a big step backward. And another moment was realizing that the graduate education program had to be all women. I was so struck by that, and how they went looking for these recent graduates from the women's colleges, especially coming out of that book from the 1870s. What big steps had been made in only 50 years.
Did any of the Harvard women go to the observatory in Peru to work there?
Did any of the Harvard women go to Peru? Yes. Miss Harvard went down there. Miss Cannon was the first one. Of course, Mrs. Bailey was there from the beginning. Miss Cannon went when she was in her late 50s, and she operated the telescope, she walked the 5 miles into town and back. She had the time of her life, and she wrote about it. I would also just like to make the point again of how fair the dealings were. How willing Pickering and Shapley were to credit the women for their work. You know, Shapley had this funny term. He said he measured the jobs in girl hours. And if they were really hard jobs, they might be killer girl hours. But they really supported the women and gave them the credit and the chance. Chance to excel. And in so many of the stories you hear, that's not the case. And there's always a question about Miss Leavitt. You know, she made this phenomenal discovery, but she didn't personally take it to the next step. And was that because Pickering didn't let her, or Shapley didn't let her? Or was it just that wasn't what she felt like doing? Nobody knows. You'll hear it said that she was forced to to stick with lesser work because Pickering wanted, I'm quoting now, he was interested in results not in thinking. But that was Cecilia Payne who said that, and she never met Pickering. He was dead when she got here. So I don't know how she could be so certain that that was the case for Miss Leavitt. And it's just not known. But I don't like to see the men get a bad rap. All right.
Defend yourself.
Anybody else?
Yeah, check.